right, so I will welcome everybody. We are recording this session for our YouTube listeners and for those who cannot join us right now, but will want to listen in and then join us for the concert. Magdalena, thank you so much for being here with us. You know, we are very excited to have you back. You're our lecturer in residence, and it's very exciting to hear about the upcoming program. It was a last minute change we had to pivot, and unfortunately Eric is not joining us, but Vyacheslav Gryaznov is joining us, and he has proposed a beautiful program, and I thought it would be just absolutely perfect. It's completely up your alley, you know, every single composer. So I can't wait to hear what you have to say about the upcoming program.
Thank you so much, Milana. It's wonderful to see you all. As I was saying before, I am joining you tonight. It's already tonight where I am. I'm in Krakow, Poland. I will be performing a recital here tomorrow, so please cross your fingers for me. I think it's going to be a lot of fun. It's very beautiful here. Now, I'm so happy, Milana, that you pronounced the name Slava Gryaznov, because I did it wrong on the video recording before. I said Gryaznov, but it's Gryaznov. Okay, it's very good to know how to correctly do it. And Slava, many of you may already be familiar with his talent from a concert with the Grand Piano Series in the past, a few years ago. There are actually some wonderful videos of that performance on YouTube, and I, with great pleasure, was browsing through them, and I'll even share one with you today because it's just so wonderful. Slava is known not only as a pianist, but also as a great transcriber of music, really following the tradition of great pianists such as Franz Liszt or Leopold Godowsky. So if you're lucky, maybe he'll play one of his transcriptions for an encore. In the meantime, in the program as he has planned it, includes music of Jean-Philippe Rameau, Frédéric Chopin, and Sergei Rachmaninoff. And, you know, I get very excited when I get to talk about Baroque music, and especially dance music. And so that's where we will start. And maybe I'll try to spend a little more time on Rameau, since he may be the least known to piano fans, as his music has really been written for the harpsichord. You know, he's an 18th century composer. And so the piano, as we know it today, did not yet exist, and his repertoire is only now being added to the pianist's toolbox. I could probably say, well, it's only just a few past decades, and it's really increasing in popularity, which makes me very, very happy. It's just such a wonderfully catchy and at the same time very sophisticated music. So Slava is going to start with four pieces from the Nouvelle Suite, so the new suite of harpsichord pieces. So that's something that we already have to keep in mind, that since the music was written for a slightly different instrument that has different capabilities, there's already quite a bit of adjustment going on the part of the pianist. Let me just admit three people who are here. Brilliant. As many of you who already attended the talk that I did maybe last season on the dance music, where we're talking about the various dance movements played on the keyboard, but you're new to the series, I'm going to just very quickly recap for you what we talked about then. So the culture of dance and the culture of what we know today as ballet was really developed at the court of Louis XIV at Versailles. And Louis XIV's court composer was Jean-Baptiste Lully. He was really the true kind of trendsetter, composing music, mostly operas, but as the king really loved dance, and he was a fantastic dancer himself, and so he mostly loved to see himself dance while others were, admiring. Lully was really in charge of writing tons and tons of dance music. And so Jean-Philippe Rameau is inheriting that tradition from Lully. He's kind of the second in line of that really, really powerful cultural influence in Europe. And that's where I'd like to start presenting you with some really nice videos today. This video is a choreography, as you see. It's not an opera set, but it's an outdoor kind of a situation where we see the dance of the so-called savages. It comes from the opera of Rameau called Les Indes Galantes. So this is the 18th century sort of imagination of what our continent was or may have been like. So just look at the Baroque dance and all its glory for a moment and listen to how unbelievably catchy this tune is. Here we go, the Dance of the Savages. It's got that unbelievable swagger to it. Of course, the details of Baroque choreography are way too many to cover in today's session, but you see this very complex footwork, and this is all, again, a sort of a brainchild of Louis XIV, and a fashion that really permeates throughout Europe, where every self-respecting household had a dance master and was memorizing a choreography for the next ball. And really, the dance, and I always repeat it, but it's so true, dance was an incredibly important social currency at the time. If you wanted to be a part of any kind of significant crowd, you had to know the latest choreographies. Now, this is a modern rendition from the actual opera Les Indes Galantes, and you will hear it in a production which today, already after maybe just a decade, can already seem slightly problematic, because you're going to see, you know, Native Americans dancing in a certain way and, you know, being called savages here. But that's beside the point here. What I want to demonstrate to you is the entertainment value that the operas of Rameau still have today. So let's take a quick look. Same tune, this time it is sung, and you'll see the choreography. So really, all just to say again how this music is meant to delight and entertain, and again the value of dance, even in operas, you know, larger shows, there was at least 20 minutes worth of uninterrupted dance in the so-called, you know, suite de ballet. So dance was, I cannot, you know, overemphasize the importance of that, of dance. Now, here is the same tune, and that has nothing to do yet with actual recital program, but this is one of the most famous tunes of Rameau, and I want to show you how things work. So from that opera and from the dance choreography, we are now transferring the piece onto the harpsichord, and I want you to just hear a fragment of it. And So, and here is this rather eccentric but wonderfully talented young harpsichordist Jean Rondeau. He's making big waves today. So I wanted to also introduce you to him. Now we are moving to the actual music. And let me first play, oh yes, here it is, the harpsichord rendition of a piece that Slava will play called Le Trois Mains, the Three Hands. And it is a sort of a fandango where you count the beats in interchangeably in two and then in three. So I will try to conduct it while we're listening to the video so you can understand how it works. So 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3. This is the kind of a very sensuous rhythm in this dance. Now, the trois mains, what could the three hands possibly mean? Well, the dance, the fandango, would have been normally danced in a couple. So here we are either thinking about a third dancer possibly joining a choreography, or Rameau simply trying to create an impression of three hands playing the keyboard. And well, in this one, you actually will see the keyboardist's hands, but I will play the next video in which you won't. And then I want you to just close your eyes and listen to how many hands you actually hear. You know, Rameau was an incredibly innovative musician. He wrote a treatise on harmony, but he also was inventing new ways of playing the keyboard, so really pushing the technique forward. And I think that the trois mains, the three hands, may be an attempt to do that. Let's hear.
Magdalena, you're on mute at the moment, so if you can unmute yourself. Yeah.
I see. Okay, here
yeah, I am. So there is a feedback when you play the music. So every time you play something, if you could mute yourself, that would be great.
Okay, I'll do that. Could you hear this last example, or should I
replay? Yes, example we heard. We couldn't hear you afterwards.
I see. Okay, that's what's happening. Okay, so let me close this one. Okay, absolutely. Yes, so here you hear, you also saw the keyboardist's hands kind of crossing arms, and this is one of those innovations of Rameau. Now we're going to hear that same piece played on the modern piano, and so that's where we're starting to enter the territory of what Slava is going to be doing. Here's pianist Marcel Meyer, same piece. You will also notice that it sounds a little bit higher. Harpsichords are traditionally tuned to just a little bit lower A. So instead of it being 440 hertz, it would be tuned to 415 hertz. So this will sound a bit more high strung. Actually, you know what? I need to now mute myself. But how do I? Milana, could I ask you to mute me? Because if I'm sharing screen, I don't see the mute button. If you would just mute me. Thank you. Okay, I'm unmuted now. I hope you can hear me. Yes, so if you were able to close your eyes and just sort of imagine where each hand would be playing, it's very easy to picture actually three hands playing the keyboard. It's because that left hand is crossing over the right, and that creates a feeling of that third extra hand being there. So I definitely encourage you to watch Slava very closely. You know where the seats are, where you get the keyboard view. So that would be very, very entertaining to witness. Now, one more Rameau before we move on, and it is actually a performance of my own, because the piece that Slava will play for you, it belongs to one of my dearest, my most favorite sarabands. So for those of you who have already been with us for a while, you probably now know that of the court dances that were presented at the court of Louis XIV, the saraband was the one rare dance that was not done in couples, right? It was done by the most virtuosic solo dancer. And that, of course, the court, it would have been the king, but it was not for the faint of heart. The choreography involved unbelievable, you know, leaps and incredibly sophisticated movements of the wrists. And, you know, that all comes on top of these highly ornate costumes and laces and so on. So I'd love you to imagine that dance as you were listening to the saraband. I should add, however, that those keyboard dances were actually not meant to accompany a choreography. They're so-called stylized, meaning similarly to, you know, Chopin mazurkas or Chopin waltzes. They were actually meant as simple keyboard pieces, but they are supposed to evoke the feeling of dance. So if Milana could mute me, I'm going to share my screen. And here's a here we go. I am unmuting myself. This is a performance from some years ago at the International Keyboard Institute. So another thing that you may want to pay attention to when you go and hear Slava play is that in these dances, the form is always going to be binary. So you're always going to hear each half of the piece twice, AA, BB. And the performance practice dictates to make slight variations on the repeat. So if you were able to catch some of them already in my own performance, you know, it has to be done very subtly. You cannot just pack the second, the repeat with, you know, every possible ornament that you've ever learned, but it's a really lovely practice to sort of just vary a little bit. And in a dance itself, the choreography would actually never repeat the same way twice. So the choreography was kind of through composed. And so even though the music may have repeated, the steps were already quite different by then. So a bunch of things to pay attention to: the ornamentation, the fact that the pieces are written for an instrument that is a plucked instrument, right? A harpsichord is a plucked instrument with the sound closer to the guitar. And, you know, how do you translate that on the piano, which, you know, I think he's going to play the gorgeous Fazioli again, right? And so it has a totally different range of possibilities than a harpsichord. For one, you know, the harpsichord is not capable of crescendo and diminuendo, so getting louder and getting softer. So how is a pianist to negotiate that? You know, do you play sort of faithfully to the score without any dynamic gradations, or do you actually take advantage of the piano and its expressive capabilities. So that's definitely a choice that a pianist faces. And yeah, I personally find it very exciting. Okay, so we are now moving from the French Baroque music to the music of Chopin. And so many of you are well familiar with the repertoire. And of course, it's a bread and butter of any pianist. And you're going to be treated to the first ballade of Chopin. It was written in 1835-6. So Chopin at that time would have been 25-26 year old. So really still a very young man. And as we know, he never really got to be old. He died at the age of 39 from tuberculosis. In fact, he was said to have been dying slowly his entire life. Since his early childhood, he was already pretty sickly. He visited many spas with his parents in hopes of improving his health. And so, but that was never to be. By that time, Chopin is already living in Paris. He has left Poland at age 20. First, he went on a few concerts abroad in Vienna, where, you know, he was received actually so a little bit kind of a lukewarm reviews because of how delicate his playing was, and his sound was not really projecting that well. And so the reviews would say that in order to appreciate Chopin's talent, one must really be sitting in the first couple of rows, otherwise there's just no point. Chopin, once he moves to Paris, he really stops performing in concert situations. He will mostly be giving salon performances and improvising for just a select group of people by the candlelight. But the kind of concerts as we know them today were a rarity for Chopin, unlike Liszt, who of course, you know, invented the whole formula of the piano recital, and we talked about that last time, how he was really the only one in the spotlight. He also invented the idea of playing the entire recital from memory, and to this day many pianists, including myself, hate him for it. But let's not digress, let's go back to the music of Chopin. So the title ballade is already pretty telling that this is going to be a piece with extra musical suggestions, right? And Chopin was rather conservative with naming his pieces, you know, while Liszt would say, oh, Saint Francis talking to the birds, or, you know, the fountains of the Villa d'Este, you know, Chopin would just say waltz or mazurka, or in this case ballad. So that's all we get, and the rest is really up to us, up to our imagination. What we do know is that a ballad is suggestive of poetry, and the term ballad was really used for poetry up till the 18th century or so. And Chopin, as an emigre, was friends with a poet, and some of you may already know his name, Adam Mickiewicz. They were both in Paris, and this is, as I remind everyone always, this is during the time where Poland as a sovereign country did not exist on the map of Europe. So there was a huge push from artists to create art, you know, on immigration, and continue the Polish identity despite the fact that the country was not existent. And so the ballads of Mickiewicz were these really epic poems, multiple pages, and you know, they really, if you're familiar with the poetry of Goethe, they bring to mind that kind of a landscape. Dark woods, you know, we're talking about lots of supernatural, but very dark imagery. You know, we're talking about, you know, two sisters in the woods, you know, fighting for the love of a man who promises to marry the one who gathers more berries. And, you know, the sister would kill one of her own in order to win that challenge and be able to marry the young man. And so the blood gets mixed with the berries that were gathered. So it's pretty dark. And there is no evidence that Chopin was basing his ballads up for the piano, of which there are four, on any particular ballad of Mickiewicz, but the general idea, the general mood is there. So now I'm going to mute myself and play for you the beginning of the first ballad in G minor. And I want you to listen to how it opens. It's got this very recitative-like, speech-like style where we still don't have a tempo, we don't have an established key. It's just sort of inviting us in, grabbing our attention. Let's listen.
Magdalena, we don't hear anything at the moment. I think you didn't share the screen, maybe.
So Chopin, after this, finally finds his key, and after that, he will go on with a melody that recurs throughout the whole piece. But what's really even more exciting than the melody is that heartbeat-like accompaniment. So let me keep playing for a few more seconds. And so on. So notice that heartbeat that's always there. And when the music gets more excited, the heartbeat will get also faster and more intense. There will also be moments of skipping a beat. So these very kind of pregnant pauses, very dramatic silences are also a big part of the ballad. But it will really be up to you to create your own story, to create your own mood around the piece. And every pianist and every concert goer has their own version of it. I'm very curious whether some of you may already be familiar with this ballad. I will just tell you that for any pianist who has played it for a teacher or learned it, those opening few bars, that recitative, is something that we spend countless hours on figuring out. It's not, I see some of you smiling, and it's not pianistically difficult to play. It's just this unmeasured melody that's looking for the key, is this modulating. But my goodness, have I sat through so many master classes where the teacher would not even let the student go to that main tune that you just heard because they were stuck for a full hour on that introduction. And that's how important it is to set the right mood. So really tune up your ears for this and see how Slava does it. Every pianist has their own very unique way of doing it. So there are moments also in the piece, and I will show you two more moments. And since I have to mute myself, I'll show them to you consecutively. There is that melody in about 3 minutes in that contrasts the sort of the opening the heartbeat situation, and it's very, very lyrical and warm. And again, that's something that will keep coming back. The piece concludes with an incredibly dramatic and dark coda. And, you know, I was just practicing at the Krakow Academy of Music here, and sure enough, when you walk down the hallway, you hear at least one person always practicing that coda. Whichever conservatory in the world you go to, somebody's going to be practicing that coda. It is challenging, not only after, you know, all the 10 minutes of you know, playing, you are physically really challenged to kind of keep your stamina, but also keeping the drama of the piece and allowing it to climax is an incredible joy, and but also a great challenge. So here come those two spots, the lyrical tune about 3 minutes in, and the coda closer to 8 minutes. I'm muting myself. Okay, and now one more thing I want to show you about this ballad, and it's the very end. It is one of the strangest passages, I have to admit, in Chopin's music. You're going to hear G minor scale a bunch of times, that sort of is interrupted very rapidly, and then you're going to hear these soft chords, only to conclude with this unbelievable kind of heartbreaking passage that is so highly chromatic, and it's performed at the outer edges of the keyboard, of the register, that you have a feeling that Chopin actually has gone mad. And that is very unusual for him. He's usually very composed. The emotions are, you know, they run hot, but they're always in check. This is the one moment where the music really becomes insane. So let's listen to that. So for those of you who have heard this ballade maybe countless times by now, definitely take a listen to how Slava goes about that ending. It is really kind of unkempt in a way, very ungroomed, for especially for somebody like Chopin. Now we're going to move to the music of Sergei Rachmaninoff, and that will be a real treat because we're going to hear quite a few pieces. The first one maybe be one of the among the more famous positions in the pianist's repertoire, and it already is something that intermediate to advanced pianists are starting to tackle, and that is the G minor prelude, opus 23, and number 5. When we think of preludes, the concept of preludes, the name that immediately comes to mind is Johann Sebastian Bach and his well-tempered clavier, the, you know, 24 preludes and fugues in all keys. And then there are composers who pay Bach tribute by writing preludes as well. Chopin was definitely one of them, except he did not have fugues that followed the preludes. And Rachmaninoff ended up doing the same thing, although he did not really set out to write a full cycle of 24 preludes in all major and minor keys the way that Bach did. But it so eventually happened that he ended up with 24 between his prelude in C sharp minor opus 3 and then the opus 23 and 32. We ended up with 24 preludes in all major and minor keys. The prelude that you're about to hear is, like many of them, in ternary form, meaning A, B, A. You're going to always hear the return of the opening material one more time, after a contrasting middle section. And that is the case with a lot of the romantic miniatures, you know, the short pieces. We hear the A, B, A is kind of familiar, right? Where we went ourselves with the material. This prelude many times has been kind of described as military. In fact, there was quite a bit of military background in Rachmaninoff's own family. His father was a military man, and he wanted to send young Sergei to military school, but it turned out that he couldn't afford it. Well, luckily for us, because we wouldn't have the Rachmaninoff, the composer and the pianist, perhaps, had he gone to the army. So I'm going to mute myself, and here is a treat. You're going to actually hear Slava himself from a few years ago performing for the Grand Piano Series, that very prelude. And there is that beautiful aristocratic restraint with which he plays. That is something that is actually sort of the version 2.0 of musical interpretation. So the emotions, as you all know by now, emotions in the Rachmaninoff's music are incredibly high, and sometimes for a musician who's performing it, rather hard to control. But Slava is doing it masterfully here. So listen to okay, so that ternary form, as I promised, comes with a very contrasting middle section. And so you're going to hear these very sweeping, long melodies that Rachmaninoff was so well known for, with chords modulating, you know, and harmonizing in the most innovative way. We often take Rachmaninoff's music for granted these days, but there's just so much happening in it. And I do really encourage you to listen with a fresh ear. Rachmaninoff is also always a student of Bach's polyphony. And so even though you might be on a surface just hearing the melody and accompaniment, there is a lot of times in the left hand, the thumb is actually going to be playing an alternative melody, kind of a counter melody, a very similar way that Bach would have done in his polyphonic music. So let me move to about 1.5 minutes in and listen to these sweeping, lengthy melodies. But then look at his left thumb and you're going to see that there's a whole lot happening in terms of counterpoint, which is the art of writing in multiple voices at a time. I'm muting. And that brings us back to that military rhythm. But I was trying to point out a little bit with my thumb. So definitely listen for that. That's kind of the new level of listening if you already are familiar with the piece on its surface. A couple of more, we won't have time to go over all of the preludes, but here is one from Opus 32, number 5. And I love to just think of it as kind of a Killing Me Softly prelude, because it's just so gorgeous, but it just sort of sneaks up on you in this most sweet and all, you know, embracing way. And as you sort of get into that groove of this kind of quintuple rhythm in the left hand, you become completely taken by it. I'm going to share a version with Vladimir Horowitz. Yeah, I'm muted now. So this is just a kind of in a nutshell about the preludes. And now I'm going to just mention quickly, so not to run out of time, a quick word about the etudes. An etude, from the word étudier, in French meaning to study, is essentially an exercise, right? And These exercises have been written by people like Carl Czerny, who was a pupil of Beethoven, and all these people, Hanan, you know, if you ever took piano, you probably went through a bunch of Hanan exercises for dexterity and making sure your fingers, Sally, I see some people nodding, making sure that your fingers are nice and strong and they sound even and that nothing sticks out. Well, after a while, that kind of became predictable and boring, although, you know, there's still merit to doing those exercises and solidifying one's technique. But when people like Chopin, Liszt, and then Rachmaninoff came along, the etude became a completely different animal. It became really a concert piece. I mean, how many of you would like to actually hear a Czerny exercise on stage, right? But these etudes are little dramas of their own, and so within 3-4 minutes you're going to experience an entire very dramatic story, which still serves its function as an etude. So this is one of the favorites here in opus 39, number 5, the E-flat minor. And I should also mention that the etudes in both opuses of Rachmaninoff's etudes 33 and 39 were also called by the composer himself tableau, so picture etudes. He doesn't tell us which etude paints what picture. He leaves this up to you. You probably have heard a couple of Debussy preludes where he gives us title kind of suggestions of titles at the end of the piece after a dot 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 in parentheses. But Rachmaninoff doesn't even do that. He says, well, you decide for yourself what you want this etude to represent to you. But in the meantime, here we are, you know, practicing our skills. In this case, these are big, heavy chords. And again, like I said before, controlling one's emotion, not to lose the entire steam on the first page and not to start banging, which is something that happens to many of us at the piano. We just can't handle how powerful this music is, and we just want to put all our body and soul into it, and before we know it, we're out of steam on page 2. So I do have Slava's recording of this etude, so just listen to how he controls the tension. We're only going to hear a few seconds. I'm muting myself. So that gives you an idea of this high, high drama, incredibly dark piece. He also picks the one of the darkest keys that there are, E flat minor. This piece would not have sounded the same in, let's say, even a half step higher in the key of E minor. The color of it would have already been very, very different. So Rachmaninoff, there's certainly a lot of sort of autobiographical pain that's in this music. Some of you may already know that Rachmaninoff went through a huge bout of deep, deep depression and didn't write for several years. And it was thanks to his therapist, to whom he dedicated his famous second concerto, that he was able to sort of stand on his feet again and start writing. But not for long, though. Rachmaninoff left Russia in 1917, and really once he moved to the US, he settled in Beverly Hills, and he was a successful pianist. He had a good life. He said, you know, I lost my country, I lost myself. And he never really wrote that much after that. So most of his music comes from the time where he was still in Russia up till 1917. While he was in Russia, and I see that we're running out of time, so but I want to share a very important thing with you, which is that there are several things to listen for in Rachmaninoff's music, and that will be definitely that drama and despair. He was also known to have had the most enormous hands, you know, with a span of a 13th, which, you know, I, on a good day, I have a span of a 10th. So he had probably another 2 inches of a span in his hand. He suffered greatly physically. He had all kinds of ailments that were bothering him. And, you know, sort of spent a lot of time, you know, in retreat, trying to, you know, heal and improve his health. But there is that despair. There are two things that he was exposed to thanks to his grandmother, and those were the bell sounds and the Orthodox Russian religion. So many of the melodies that you're going to hear harken back to those chorales that you would have heard in a Russian Orthodox church, a very serious, solemn, with low voices, very dignified. And then there will be the bell sounds, and it's not just going to be one bell sound. There are going to be millions of different sizes and shapes of bells. So just from time to time, close your eyes and listen for these really ringing tones. You know, this is also the time where we finally have the piano, the Steinway piano, as we see the pianos on stage. So Rachmaninoff is truly, unlike Rameau, right, who wrote for the harpsichord, Rachmaninoff truly is exploring the full range of the piano capabilities. And the last few seconds of a piece that I want to share with you is a famous C sharp minor prelude, which does have all these bell sounds of various types. The prelude became so popular, and everyone asked Rachmaninoff to play it when he was visiting the US on tour, that he ended up actually despising the piece and saying he never wants to hear it again. But here it is, and I know you love it, and just listen for those bells. I'll mute myself one last time. Yes, so I'll leave the musical examples here, and you're going to hear again this beautiful piano played by a master pianist. So listen for that resonance and all these variations of bell sounds.
Thank you, Magdalena. As always, we are very grateful for your beautiful pre-concert lecture, for putting us in the mood for this wonderful recital. I honestly can't wait to welcome Slava here. He was here, you know, 4 years ago, and It's just a joy to welcome him back. And if you don't have a ticket yet, December 14 at 7:30 p.m. in Bonita Springs, join us for Vyacheslav Gryaznov, who is going to play Rameau, Chopin, and Rachmaninoff. So tell all your friends, it's a recital not to be missed, as of course all our recitals. So we really hope to see you there. If we have just a minute or so, if anybody wants to or has any questions, let us know. I will get the gallery view. Michael, you have something. Okay, so can you unmute yourself and ask a question?
Yes, you said that given that the pieces were written before, that the artist has to make a choice on how they play it. How do you approach that decision?
Oh goodness, it's really you think about it forever, and you come and you try various approaches. You learn about the composer, the circumstances, you know, the instruments that were available to them, and then you try to do what's also true to you, right? So there are a million different considerations, and I even see from some of my earlier performances that my view of interpretation of certain works changes over time. I'm thinking, oh, well, that was so youthful and immature and fast. And now I'm so wise and I'm going to do things differently. So it's a constant discovery. It's such a great question. We could have a whole session just on that. Thanks for that, Michael.
Maybe that's the topic for discussion. Thank you for ideas, Michael. Yes. Anyone else has any questions? All right. Well, I look forward to seeing all of you on December 14. And thank you one more time. Enjoy your concert tomorrow. Best of luck. You know, we'll keep our fingers crossed for your success.
Thank you.
Yes.
There's no doubt about that, however.
Oh, you're so sweet, Melissa. Thank you.
If you're on Instagram, check out Magdalena's video post from Krakow. So,
definitely
on our channel and her page. Thank you so much and have a wonderful evening and good night to you, Magdalena.
Thank you very much, everybody. See you next time.
Bye-bye. Bye.